God, and in the encouragement you'll find correction, in the encouragement you'll find rebuke maybe, or some chastening, but it's good for you. Proverbs chapter 14, verse number 29. I want to share with you just for a few moments from the topic, consider it again. Somebody say, consider it again. Sometimes things are worth a second look, and you could look over your blessing, and you can look over your promise, and you could look over people that God's really placed in your life to bless you and to be an encouragement to you. You can look over doors and opportunities when you're in a rush. Amen. Some of your greatest opportunities have not been missed because God didn't bring them to you. They've been missed because you were rushing. They were missed because you were in haste. You were so quick. And if you came out of my generation, we say you were just trying to be fast. Are you understanding this? And you're going to have to really in this season, because this season is so potent. It's so filled with potential. It's so filled with possibility. It's filled with so many great things that you're going to have to calm yourself down, and you're going to have to be like the Word of God says. You're going to have to be anxious for nothing. You're going to have to be so calm that even when situations come that seem like emergencies, you're able to discern when it's not. And you're able to slow yourself down and do just like the Word says, be still and know that I'm God. Amen. You're going to have to be like the Word says in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, where he says, stand still to see the salvation of the Lord. If you're going to see the salvation of the Lord, and the word salvation just simply means God saving you out of anything. I'm not just talking about the salvation of your soul. All right. That word salvation comes from the word soteria. All right. That means to be saved out of anything. That means to be saved out of financial calamity, calamity in your family, calamity in your home, calamity in your mind, calamity on the job. He is your present Savior. Amen. He is not just a past Savior that you received when you first got saved. He is your present Savior. That's why the Word says there's no temptation that will ever come upon your life. No level of testing wherewith God will not make a way of escape. Jesus himself will manifest in every situation as what? The door. Y'all ain't talking here. He said, I am the door. Y'all ain't talking here. What's he saying in his word, people? He said, I am the way. He said, I'm your entrance out if you'll stand still and if you'll wait for me. If you'll wait for my appearance, if you'll wait for me to show up, if you'll wait for me to make myself visible, you'll be able to come through me unharmed. Are you hearing this? I said, you'll be able to wait for me, come through me, and be untampered, not tampered with, or uncontaminated. And the reason why some of us go through things and we come out of it smelling like smoke, we come out of it, glory to God, being contaminated, is because we did not come out of it through Christ. We choose other methods. Are y'all going to listen to this? We choose other methods and ways out of it. And God says, if you want to come through it clean, if you want to come through it with your hands not being dirtied, with the mess people try to throw on you, just wait on me to show up and then come through me. Because when you come through me, you'll come through the blood. And there's nothing, y'all ain't talking, that can, y'all ain't talking, be unpurified when you come through the blood. Hallelujah. The reason why, all right, the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the reason why they were able to sit there, listen to this, all right, sit there in the fiery furnace. Are you hearing this? All right, they turned up the heat seven times harder. All right, they wanted, all right, to make sure that their death was complete. We understand that seven means what? Perfection, completion. They wanted to make sure that death was complete. They did not want any possibility of anything being left alive after that particular attack. And that's what the enemy is trying to do in your lives, people of God. He wants to turn up the heat, because this time he wants to make sure that you're good and dead, and not just in your physical body, because he'll let you live, but then glory to God, cause death to your ambition, or death to your dreams, or death to your vision, or death to your heart. Are you hearing this? Somebody say, I'm going to outlive this thing. They sat there in that fiery furnace. Now watch this. All right, Nebuchadnezzar turned up seven times harder. Seven times harder. Why did he turn it up seven times harder? Because they had already boasted. Listen. They had already boasted on God. They had already said, we don't care what you do. We don't care how we come out of this. If we come out of it, we'll praise God. But let me tell you, I don't care what happens. I want you to know that our God is able to deliver us. Listen here. What do they say? They say, we will not, all right, box in the ability of God to just us coming out of this particular situation. Because sometimes you'll make people think God's not able because he didn't save you from the last thing that he allowed you to be processed through. And you're going to have to begin to tell people, okay, yeah, they repossessed the car. Yeah, I got evicted. Yeah, I lost the job. Yeah, they walked off from me. But that has nothing to do with God's ability to have brought me out of it if he wanted to. This thing right here is going to turn out to the glory of God. Y'all don't. Paul gets to a place where Paul has been brought through so many things, glory to God, so many judgments and beatings and accusations and to other people it looked like, all right, Paul was being delayed in what he was trying to do. But Paul stops there, I believe in Philippians, and he declares to them, he said, watch this. He said, I want you to know that the things that happened to me have fallen out rather for the furtherance of the gospel. He said, everything that happened in my life against me has only advanced me, has only progressed me, it's only pushed me further into the place I should have been, and has given me the power needed to give the word to you. So they sit there, listen to this, and they're in the furnace. They turn it up. They close the thing in. All right. And then they have to wait. Okay. I'm going to lose all of you right here. They're in there. The door is not opened. Huh? To them, there's no way out. And then they have to wait. They didn't get thrown in there, and 30 seconds later, they opened the door. They had to wait. In the furnace, feeling the heat, they had to wait. Y'all ain't talking. They cannot jump through the wall. They can push the stone away. Are you hearing this? They had to wait. They could not turn down the heat. They could not ask for some air conditioner or some fan. Oh, can you give us some water? They had to wait. Now, what our problem is, we're in it, but we don't want to wait in it. We're in it, but we don't want to wait in it. Hallelujah. We want to be in it and not feel anything. We want to be in it and not feel the heat. We want to be in it and not feel the pressure. We want to be in it and not feel the affliction. But God says that in his word in Isaiah that I have chosen them out of what? The furnace of affliction. He said, the people I'm choosing in this day to advance and in this day to promote are those that I'm pulling out of the furnace of affliction. How are they coming out? Through me. It is those that are waiting in the furnace, not because they can't find other ways to get out. Because, beloved, glory to God, there is always a way out of something, but it's not always the right way. Oh, y'all ain't talking. I said there's always a way out. There's always a way out. There's always some wicked scheme to get out. There's always some back way, glory to God, channel to get out. There's always some underhanded conspiracy or plan to get out, glory to God. But God says if you want to get out of it and you want to stay in the thing I'm bringing you into, you're going to have to wait in it until I appear, and then you'll come out through me. They're waiting in it, and they're experiencing all of this thing. Now watch this. This is what we don't understand. Are you listening? All right. They're in it. They're experiencing all of these things, and they're experiencing things that the people that didn't know God might experience. See, what messes up our psyche is when we have to go through things that the people that don't know God should go through. Y'all ain't talking. Because see, what we're taught is, if I know God, if you accept Jesus, your personal Savior, all right, that you'll never go through nothing, you'll never experience nothing, all right, because you got Jesus, that's your badge out of any situation, that's your badge out of any process. Somebody lift your hands if you've been a witness. That is not the truth. And the devil will tell you, you don't know God. You have no relationship with God. You have nothing. Come on, come on. If you knew God, all right, how come your power ain't working? You done fast. You already fasted 14 days, 14 nights. You've been drinking water, eating crackers and grapes, glory to God, after 6 p.m. All right, you prayed sun up to sundown. And glory to God, where's all the power? They told you if you fast, you would come out full of the power. And you fasted, came out full of the power, and came out straight into a situation that you thought your fasting what's going to bring you over. But don't you know your fasting only prepared you to walk through Christ, through the thing that y'all ain't talking, you were trying to avoid. Beloved of God, the thing that you were trying to avoid, Christ is trying to get you to confront. Y'all ain't talking. Y'all ain't talking. I said the thing you were trying to avoid, and you were trying to avoid having to ever deal with it. And Christ says, I want you to confront it because I want you to show the enemy how fearless you can be. I want you to show the enemy how strong you could be in waiting in me despite what your surroundings look like. Jesus fasted 40 days, Matthew chapter 4, and 40 nights. All right. The Bible said after he was hungered, he was in the wilderness. After that 40 days, 40 nights, he runs straight into 3 levels of testing.
Yes, that's right.
3 levels of testing. The devil tested his confidence in who he was. If you be the Son of God, go ahead, do this. Come on, let me. And then the devil tested him and says, I got a way out for you. All right, you do this. You bow down before me, I'll give you all of these things. He was trying to give the Lord a way out of that testing. But what did Jesus say? Jesus says, all right, man, he talks about man shall not live by bread alone. He talks about what the word of God says. You shall worship no other God before him. He gives the enemy the word of God during his season of waiting. And what we are lackadaisical in is giving back the word during our wait. Somebody say the word during our wait. And that brings him out. That brings him out where the Bible starts to talk about how God ministers to him, how God restores him. Are you understanding this? Because he outlasted the test by giving the enemy word during his wait. So we're back. We're back in the fiery furnace. They're waiting in the fire. Huh? No way out. Nobody's opening a door right now. They're turning up the heat. They want to make sure they're good and dead. So when you start to see these intensifying effects, we talked on last Sunday, that quite possibly the intensity of your distraction might be directly related to the intensity of your assignment. How many of y'all got that last Sunday? I said the intensity of your distraction might be directly related to the intensity of your assignment. All right, the assignment they had, the assignment upon Jesus' life, all right, was an intense assignment. All right, so the enemy had to bring before them intense distractions. He wanted to make sure they were good and dead. All right, now watch this. Nebuchadnezzar wants to check. They open it up, all right? They see Shadrach getting this, Meshach, they see Abednego. But what they also see is a fourth man in the fire who they say resembles the Son of God. Wait. We cannot, according to Matthew, are you hearing this? I'm about to mess up. We cannot be talking about what Jesus looked like, Matthew to what, John or Luke and Mark, because he had not come in the flesh yet. So they cannot be saying this is Jesus according to what the disciples saw. But they were able
to tell it was all God. Sometimes people don't want to give you credit for it being the Lord, or don't want to be a credit for being prayer, or don't want to give you credit for it being a production of your word. But what they'll have to say is, well, I know something great happened. I know it resembled something looking like God. See, Nebuchadnezzar didn't even know what Jesus looked like. But he was able to tell that only a power greater than him could have delivered them out of what he knew should have destroyed them and would destroy others before them. He had to declare that greater is he that's in them than he that was in any of those other people, because they died in this. But how in the world? What the enemy is trying to figure out, what people are trying to figure out is, what is still keeping you alive? What is still keeping you in joy? What's still keeping you preaching? What's still keeping you teaching? What is it on the inside of you? There has to be something else working in you that's keeping you alive through all of this stuff. And then you still look good. Y'all ain't talking. Bible said he'll give you beauty for ashes. You still look good. Praise the Lamb of God. Isn't it something when you walk in God and you walk in the love of God and the love of God's been perfected in you and you're walking in forgiveness, you're not holding malice, you are not bitter concerning your situation, and you're not bitter concerning other people that might have helped you get into a bad place. God, Messiah, you have counted it all joy. Don't you know when you're walking that place in God that God will not allow anything, Lord God, to be attached to you? Anything to tag you, he'll take the stigma away, he'll take the shadow of death off of you, and he will give you glory. And out of that glory, he'll let his goodness come. Are you getting this? They said the fourth man in there. There's a fourth man in there, and he looks like the Son of God. You get to the point, I want you to listen to this closely. You get to the point where in past seasons, your glory was unrecognizable. Your glory was unrecognizable. To other people, you just looked like a regular person, even though you knew you weren't. But then you hit a place, Anthony, where you've been processed enough and you've given word during your wait, huh? Where the Bible says after Jesus comes out of that water that the heavens are open, and God makes an announcement. And what is his announcement? Listen to this. He says, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. In other seasons, Jesus just walked among the people like a regular man. But when he submitted to his process, y'all ain't talking. He submitted to his process. He submitted to what the plan of God was for his life. And even in other seasons where he walked like other people and they wouldn't give him recognition, he gets to a point where he does not have to pass out any business cards. That heaven itself, y'all ain't help me. I said heaven itself makes an announcement and said, hey, wait a minute. In case you didn't know, this is my son. In case you didn't know, this is my daughter. And listen, people, this is how the announcement is going to come in your life. What the announcement is going to say is, every time God brings you out of a situation, that is what God is saying. Amen. He's saying, this is my son. This is my daughter. I got them. I don't care what they did. This is my son. This is my daughter. I got them. Y'all hearing this? I don't care what you say, how I should deal with them. This is my son. There's nothing that makes a parent more angry as another person telling them how to deal with their own kids. Won't that make you mad? Especially when you know you got good common sense. You'll say, I know how to deal with mine. You mind yours. Deal with yours. Because last time I checked, yours was around the corner looking peasy head nappy. Y'all ain't talking here. You know you say it. Glory to God. I don't know why she minded my business. And don't you know, listen. Somebody said, listen. Don't you know that's the same way God responds concerning you? No matter what you get involved in. I said, no matter what you get involved in, God is saying here, the devil don't have nothing to do with this. He needs to come. He needs to get out of my business. This is my child. This is my young. The Bible calls the enemy the accuser of the brethren. Glory to God. That means even when you mess up, God still does not give the enemy, glory to God, room to come before him, telling him, uh-huh. God said, ain't no uh-huh. This is still mine. And I'm going to bring them out how I choose to bring them out. And I'm going to protect them, and I don't care. I'm going to give them victory. When you say I should be convicting them or I should be condemning them, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are where? In Christ Jesus. And beloved of God, as long as you are in Christ Jesus, y'all ain't talking. There's no judge on earth and there's no judge in hell that can do something in your life that God does not give him permission. Y'all ain't talking to do. Because sometimes people want to give their own opinion to God. But aren't you glad today? Somebody say, I'm listening. Aren't you glad today God does not let other people talk to him about you? I said, aren't you glad that God does not let other people talk to him about you? I don't care how much people go to God saying what you deserve, or they go to other people saying what you deserve. Y'all ain't talking. All right, God has a deaf ear to other people concerning you when they're trying to mess you up, or they think a certain thing should happen. Don't you know God does not listen to them? The Bible calls him the righteous judge. Y'all don't want this, you want this? They're in there. They say, there's somebody in there. The Son of God. Archers, are you hearing this? Now they come out there. Bible says, they look at themselves. Their clothes, they weren't singed. They weren't burnt. They come out of it smelling just how they were when they went in. And what the Lord says, if you'll be patient and if you don't rush, I'll cause you to look better than you did when you went in. Proverbs chapter 14, verse number 29. I want you to listen to this. Bible says, he that is slow to wrath or patient is of great understanding, but he that is hasty of spirit promotes folly, mistakes, failure, destruction. When you are not patient, you are increasing further disaster. So when we look at the word consider, it means to think about something or someone carefully, especially in order to make a choice or decision. When we're talking about the season that we're in and how God wants us to be patient and not to rush and not to be hasty, but to consider it again, what he's basically telling us is pause, think carefully. Think carefully about the choice that you're about to make. And don't allow any level of anxiety to cause you to make a decision that you really don't want to make. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse number 8. He says, better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. And the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. He says, all right, he says, you have to convince yourself, all right, that jumping into anything prematurely is a bad idea. You have to convince yourself that jumping into anything prematurely is a bad idea. Say bad idea. Jumping into anything prematurely is a bad idea. It will always mess up. When it's not developed, when it's not ripe, when it's not mature, when you get into relationships that are not developed, that are not ripe, that are not mature, y'all ain't talking. When you get into business ventures that are not ripe, that are not developed, that are not mature, when you make financial decisions that are not ripe, that are not mature, that are not developed, are you hearing this? It's always going to mess up on you. When you try to stand in a place where you're not ripe, when you're not developed, when you're not mature, you're going to mess up. Amen. So you have to convince yourself that jumping into anything prematurely is a bad idea. And that word premature just means that it's not either not time for that situation, or you yourself are not developed enough to walk in that situation. Because don't you know there are some great doors, but until you're mature enough to handle it, you're going to mess it up? Amen. Why y'all not talking to me right now? See, sometimes we just because it's a great door does not mean you walk through the great door all right before you're ready to walk through it. Because you can walk through that great door, glory to God, as an immature adolescent, and you'll mess it up. So sometimes you have to acknowledge what the door is and then tell God, all right, God, make me ready. Somebody said, God, make me. I got one hand clap. Somebody said, God, make me ready. See, we don't want this. We don't want this. You know why we don't want to, why we don't want to ask God to make us ready? Somebody said, why? Because we're not patient enough to wait. We're so ready to get out this fire. We're so ready to get out this affliction. Y'all ain't talking. We're so fast. We got gas on our chest. We just want to get out. By any means necessary, God, get me out. The first thing smoking, I'm out of here. Whether it's a plane, whether it's a train, whether it's an automobile, whether it's a pigeon with four wings, I'm out of here. But don't you know, all right, when you have developed your weight, when you develop your patience, you are not trying to get out of one fire to jump in another fire that you yourself create because of your premature movement. When you develop your weight, you will tell other people, no, I know this looks like what I'm in is bad, but I don't want to get into that and then it becomes worse. Because sometimes we exacerbate our own condition. We make our own conditions worse, all right, by making one bad decision after another bad decision after another bad decision after another bad decision. I'm going to mess with you right now. If you are trying all you know how to pay back the payday advance, please, all right, common sense is not to take out one more payday advance to pay that payday advance off.
Y'all ain't talking. It's common sense. If you're fighting vigorously to get out of a high, sharp, all right, condition of a loan, all right, not to take out another high, sharp condition of a loan, am I talking to you today? It's common sense if you are having all hell paying a $500 car note not to go out and get another car that you have to pay $700 for.
No, I don't want this right here because I'm trying to help this. One of the things I love about the kick is I'm trying to help this. I'm trying to help you make wise decisions that are not promoted by some fantasy of what you want your life to be. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes that it's going to get beautiful. It's going to get beautiful, but it can only get beautiful if you come to the end of it, if you walk it out. Somebody said, I got to walk it out and wait. 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 I just got to walk it out and wait. I got to walk it out and wait. I got to walk it out and wait. And while I'm walking it out and waiting, I'm giving word during my wait. I'm giving word during my wait. I'm not just giving word to the situation. I'm giving word to my own spirit. The Bible says you minister to yourself in psalms and singing spiritual hymns and worshiping God and declaring the word of God. And sometimes you sing the word back to them. Y'all ain't talking here. That's what David did. David sung the word to the Lord. Hallelujah. He picked up the song of the Lord, which is a prophetic song that is not anything anybody's written. And he worshiped God from the song of the Lord of his heart. And don't you know some of your times of walking it out, you're going to have to worship God in your own song, in your own prayer. Don't you know you can worship a prayer to God? You can sing a prayer to God. You can tell God how wonderful He is, how strong He is in you, how mighty He is to deliver you. And the Bible said you build up your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Every now and again, you have to pray in the Holy Ghost. Praise the Lamb of God. And if you don't pray in tongues, pray in the Spirit. Handa, pray the word out. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. What are you doing? Building yourself up in the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Ghost. The Bible said the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings and moanings that cannot be uttered. I don't know about you, but there have been some situations in my life that it would have been a detriment if I prayed in my own understanding. And my only response was to pray in the Holy Ghost. Because the Spirit knows and knew what I was feeling. He knew what I was going through. I had to pray in the Hamashah. And what happens, all of a sudden, you feel strength starting to come in your spirit. You feel the boldness of the Lord. Y'all know I helped me preach. I said, you feel the boldness of the Lord, Mama Wine, starting to come out of you, and now you feel stronger. And you go, Mashah, have you ever done it? You go through that house like a battering ram. Glory to God. It's just you in that house. Glory to God, you alone. And you're walking through that house. Y'all ain't talking. And you marching. You walking through that house, throwing open doors. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Declaring the word of God. Ta-ta-ta-ta, Mashah. Have you ever been to that strength hits your belly? Y'all ain't talking here. I'm not just talking about your mouth. I'm talking about that strength hits your belly, and you saw Walker in that house, and you said, no weapon formed against me will prosper. You ain't trying to be calm. You ain't trying to be weak. Y'all ain't talking. You're not trying to be nice. You set your face like a stone, and you said, devil, no weapon formed against me will prosper. I don't care what you're trying. I bind you in the name of Jesus. I'm not Messiah. I've got the word in my heart. I've got the word in my mouth. And you shall not win. Glory to God. That warfare comes out of your heart. That warfare comes out of your soul. And the word becomes strength to your bones. Where Psalms 144 declares that He'll teach our fingers how to make, our hands how to make war, and our fingers how to fight. And then El Gabor starts to rise. The God of war starts to rise. Hana on the inside of you, and you get your boldness back. Ah, yes, God. You've got the same situation, but you get your boldness back. I dare you to tap your neighbor on the shoulder and tell your neighbor, get your boldness back. Get your boldness back now. Get your boldness back. No. You've been timid in this last situation. Get your boldness back. All right. I know you cried, and I know it hurts you, and I know you're a little bit discouraged today. Get your boldness back. Glory to God. I know it's not how you wanted to go, and I know you might have made some decisions that have got you into this place, but get your boldness back. Get your boldness back. Get your boldness back. Are you hearing this? You don't know. You have to be strong now. Bible said, in the Lord and in the power of His might. He said, put on what? The whole armor of God, that you may what? Withstand the wiles of the devil. The mental attacks on your mind. Because most of the time, it's not against anything natural. It's the attack against your mind.
Yeah, that's right.
And your thoughts. Just your feelings are all unbalanced now.
Sometimes you don't know if God is real or not, whether I should believe or not. Is all this a smoke screen, all this stuff I've been doing all my life? Have you ever been there? Has all this been for nothing? Sometimes those attacks on your mind make it feel like God's gonna let you go through all of the things that you served him so hard to come out of. You say, God, what's all this for? Mashiach. And then 1 Corinthians starts to preach to you. Where he says, be steadfast, unmovable. Always, I wish I had a preacher in the room. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. I want to encourage you and declare to your heart today, it's going to pay off. Wow, Shia, hallelujah to the Lamb of God. I said it's going to pay off. Woo! Somebody shout, it's going to pay off for me. Come on, shout, it's going to pay off for me. Ooh. All of that is going to pay off. Every time you did the right thing in a bad situation, it's going to pay off. Every time you acknowledge the bad mistakes you made, it's going to pay off. Every time you served others, even when they would not serve you, it's going to pay off. Every time you kept your mouth shut when you could have said something to destroy somebody else in retaliation, it's going to pay off. Every time you let God vindicate you and you did not seek your own vengeance, it's going to pay off. Every time you loved when you were despitefully used, it's going to pay off. Every time you prayed and it still happened, it's going to pay off. Somebody say, be steadfast. You have to convince yourself, I'm almost done. Okay. You have to convince yourself that jumping into anything prematurely is a bad idea. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse number 8. Bible says that the Amalekites invaded Ziklag. They took David's wives, his children, all of his possessions. They burned everything with fire. David's men spake of stoning him. They lifted up their voice and wept. That's how I know sometimes, glory to God, emotion is in order. Are you hearing this? Emotions sometimes are in order. You cannot tell people that there won't be days they'll have to lift up their voice and weep. That's why the Bible said we weep with those that weep. We rejoice with those that rejoice. I've learned to weep with people that weep. I've learned not to tell them, all right, don't weep. All right, if the situation calls for it, weep. Well, I'll get right on the side of you and weep with you. Glory to God. But there's a time after the weeping that you need to get some answers. Because when you go through certain situations, your body has to release it. And some of y'all are all bound up because you never let it go out of your body. Y'all don't want to help me preach? I said you never let it go out of your body. And you're so filled with frustration. You're so filled with irritation. You're so filled with anxiety. Glory to God, you never let it go. Amen. Out of your body. And you're gritting your teeth every day. Glory to God, on edge. I mean on edge. People can't say anything to you because you're always on edge. That's right. Come on.
I mean, they're trying to say the right thing, and you might have heard it wrong or interpreted it wrong, and you just go out for blood. You're on edge. You know why you're on edge? Because you never let it go out of your emotions. You never let it go out of your body. That's why sometimes in prayer, you hit a point when you just start weeping. Ladies, you just start travailing and wailing. Why? Because it has to come out. And then when you come out of that, you feel better. Why? Because you've released that tension out of your body. They lifted up their voice and wept, and David wept with them because of what they had to go through. But after David dries his face, he gets up and goes and talks to the priests and tells them, bring me the ephod. Bring me to the thing that connects me to the answers. Huh? He goes, the Bible says in 1 Samuel 30 and 8, he goes and he inquired at the Lord. He asked God a question. And now somebody said, why do I need to ask? They took my wives, took my children, took my possession, burned my sin with fire. I'm going out after it. I'm going out after them. And don't you know that's called haste? Always assuming that you know the right thing to do is called haste. Your first response in any situation should be a prayer response. When you are acknowledging God in all thy ways, and what does he say, y'all? He'll direct your path. David was looking at a bad situation. The people were speaking of killing him. All right, but what does he do? Instead of him rushing out in what they thought he should do, he inquires of the Lord and asks God, okay, I know I've just lost a lot. Do you want me to have it back? Do you want me to go after him? Somebody say, I should never assume what God wants. Because some of us have made our biggest mistakes assuming what God wanted us to do. We didn't even ask. And all right. So he asked God a question. And what does the word say? And he answered him. See, sometimes, okay, all right, let's say you do ask. But most of the time, what we don't do is wait for the answer. We ask and then we get right up and do what we feel we should do without waiting. He asks a question and then he waits for the answer. And God gives him direction. James chapter 1 verse number 2. James chapter 1 verse number 2. He says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse testing and temptations. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. It develops patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given. He first says, when you get into these various testing situations, he says, I want you to know that your faith is being tried. All right, it's a trying of your faith, and it's working, it's developing your patience. He says, let patience have a perfect work. If you learn how to be well-developed in your patience, you'll always live in a perpetual state of wanting nothing, because patience will bring the product to you. I said, patience will bring the product to you. Patience will bring the fruit of your prayer to you if you'll just wait. Now watch this. He said, I want you to be perfect. I want you to be entire. I want you to be complete, wanting nothing. He says, if you lack wisdom, ask God. If you lack wisdom, ask God. If you lack wisdom, ask God. All right, what is wisdom? All right, wisdom is situational direction. That means direction out of any situation. That's what wisdom is. All right, so you don't not only ask God, all right, for things, you ask God for wisdom. Father, I'm in this. I know how I got in it.
But give me the wisdom on how you want to get me out of it. Father, I know I'm kind of picking up why this is happening. Give me the wisdom on how to walk through it. Because sometimes you just walking through something is not good enough if you don't get the wisdom on how to walk through it. You could be walking through something and not gaining anything out of your journey. No rewards, no benefits, no lessons. Are you hearing this? No blessings come out of it. All you know is you walk through it, nothing happened. You don't know what. Come on. You have to get wisdom on your journey. Wisdom through it. Proverbs chapter 4, verse number 7. He says, wisdom is a principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom with all your getting. Get what? Understanding. Ecclesiastes 3 and 11. Let me give you this last scripture. He says, the beauty. He says, he hath made everything beautiful in his time. He has made everything beautiful in his time. The beauty that's going to come out of your process can only be developed if you wait for it. The beauty that's coming out of your process can only be developed if you wait for it. You get a camera that has film in it, and in our day and time, we might not know too much about that, and our children probably might not know that there are actually cameras that have film in them. Our kids don't know because we take pictures with iPhones and iPods and all that kind of stuff. I don't know if they've ever seen a film strip. But what that photographer does is when they bring it into that photo lab, they take that strip and they put it in these solutions, and they develop the picture off of the film through a process that involves several chemical, steps and stages. And you look at that photo after it goes through that, and that photo, you see the image, but the product does not look like what it started out as. And sometimes you can let the devil convince you that you are stuck to your first level of development. Only time can bring beauty to your process. But you're going to have to wait on it. I want to give you a few things that's going to help you endure your wait. Huh? One of the greatest things that's going to help you develop your wait is by not adding things onto your life that you know you cannot handle. I am well versed in aeronology. Only you know what your ology is and how your mind operates and how your body operates. I know that if I give my phone number out to everyone that asks, I'm going to get overwhelmed. Why? Because I'm going to feel a need to communicate or feel a need to give energy that I know I don't have. And sometimes you are making connections in your life that you know you don't have the energy to maintain. You don't have the energy to maintain it, especially while you're working on something. There's some seasons that you'll just have to be okay walking through by yourself because of what you're working on. Not because you're trying to be deep or you're trying to be arrogant or you're trying to be, all that in a bag of chips. It's not that. It's that I know my mind can't handle another relationship, another friendship, another connection right now while I'm trying to accomplish all of these things. Amen. Y'all ain't talking here. Amen. So you're going to have to learn how to minister to people. Check this. Everybody you minister to is not called to walk in your life. Do you hear what I'm telling you? See, sometimes we try to make permanent relationships out of situations. God just wanted you to drop the word in and move about your business. He didn't send you to that lady's house to pray for her and then sit down and have some chicken and some tomato soup and some toast and some cheese and crackers. Sometimes you have to say, lady, I don't even know you. God sent me to pray for you. You pray for them and say, God bless you. Have a great day. And go about your business. So you don't invite things in your life that you don't know you can't handle while you're working on something. Because that'll mess up your weight. That'll mess up your weight. All right. The second thing is start to unload some stuff. Things you can get rid of that are weighting you down, get rid of them. See, a person that likes to travel, I mean, they're going all year long. I mean, from one place to another place to another place. That type of person can't have a lot of things that time down to one place. So they pack light, Ty. They pack light. That means that if I want to get up and go, I don't have to give 1,000 explanations when I'm ready to move. My third thing is, it's going to help you with your weight. It's going to help you with the weight. Get over the feeling that you're always needed. Woo, God help me. This is coming straight out of my brain right now. Get over the feeling that you're always needed, because the enemy will play that on you. And when you're trying to make a step that's going to help you, a step, oh no, I can't go because they're going to need me. I can't do this because they're going to need me. I can't do this. What are they going to do without me? Oh no, I can't take this promotion. I can't take this job. I can't buy this house. This house 20 miles away from them. What if mama need me during the night? What if Cousin Pookie and them need me to take them to the store? Let Cousin Pookie catch the Carter. Let Cousin Pookie call. Y'all ain't talking JoJo and them. Y'all ain't talking. You're not always needed. You are not always needed. And get over that. Because you'll mess up your weight and you'll start to be frustrated off of everybody else's stuff because you feel a personal responsibility to handle it for them. And now you already messed up your weight, and now you're taking ways out that you should not be taken out, not because you were in a rush, but because you've already expended all of your resources, strength, and efforts to help other people. Now you are gasping for air that was reserved for you. You've given it to somebody else. Try this. You know how they have those deep sea diving? And they take those oxygen tanks on their backs when they go deep sea diving. All right. Try this. This is how we do in situations where we feel always needed. Okay, let's say your partner who you're down there with, they all of a sudden just decide to take off their tank. Their tank sinks. Huh? Their tank sinks. So you, because you're needed, you want to rescue them. So you take off your tank. And you give them your tank. Now, it never crosses through your mind that if I take off my oxygen and give it to the person who was willfully ignorant, that I'm going to die while trying to help them live. Now, beloved of God, I know you got your Jesus complex. And I know you got your Savior complex. Where you're saying, oh, there is no greater love, no greater love than a man lay down his life for his friend. Let me tell you something. There's some situations, watch this, I know it's funny, where you understand that you only have enough resources to supply your weight. Where you have to say, God, I need you to bless her. I need you to bless him. But during this season of my life, I only have enough to supply my weight. And that's my only responsibility at this time. Not saying there won't be other time that you'll be able to help other people, but you have to be wise concerning your weight. I know this goes against what you've been hearing, but it's okay to look out for you during your weight. If you don't start to look out for you through the principles of God's word, you will be helping other people out of their situation and will be dying in your own. Why y'all don't want to talk to me during this? See, you don't want to say amen. You don't want to receive this because you want to be needed. You want, and that's how that's why you're angry right now. I'm over my time, but that's why you're angry. Let me give you the fourth reason why you'll mess up your weight. The only reason why you get angry with someone or something is because you feel as though you've given them something that they did not give you back. The only reason why you're frustrated with people you love and people you're closely connected with, watch this, y'all said it. I can't believe she didn't come. All them things I came through hers. Oh, I can't believe he didn't look out for me. He knew I was going through. Don't you know I paid half his bills when he was unemployed? Come on. Have you ever said it? And if you didn't, y'all be honest in here. If you didn't say it, you thought it. Listen, not her. Not her. After I came to rescue, when her son got into it, her daughter got into it. I know she knows. You know what keeps you out of anger? When there are situations that you know you should not get involved in and you don't. The church is quiet now because we take on responsibilities and burdens that should not be ours. You do not have to get involved in everything. There are sometimes things that you can pray for where you are. Now you have no car, nowhere to stay, no food in your house, no clothes, nothing to take care of your children with, lost your job. And your only claim to fame is that I've helped other people. I want y'all to take this today. I want y'all to take this today, and I want you to take wisdom. 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish. Now. See, we've thought that what made the 5 wise was that because they took extra oil. That is not what made them wise. What made them wise was that when the 5 foolish came to ask them for their oil, that they said no.
True. That's so true.
I had to turn my back to make sure you guys would receive that because I was scared of your face. She says, we've been preaching that the wrong way, mama. See, all of them took oil. All of them took oil. Some didn't take enough. But what made the wise wiser was that they didn't give up what they knew they needed to meet the king. Now, what's going to make you wise? You don't just want to be helpful. You want to be wise. Because if I get connected to the king, if I get connected right, once I get there, I'll be able to bless them. But you can't be a perpetual blessing to anybody, glory to God, if you don't first have sustaining ability. Joseph had to get with Pharaoh and get in the kingdom first before he was able to bless his family. I know some of y'all might not like it.
And you want to say, Jesus, I'm doing this for you. And that's why sometimes nothing happens when you pray. Because you weren't doing it for Jesus. You were doing it for you. You were doing it to build up some type of high-mindedness, or sometimes, and sometimes we don't even know we're being high-minded. We want to puff ourselves up by doing a lot for other people so they can go around saying we've done a lot. Oh, she fed the hungry. Oh, she clothes other people. Oh, she always doing something. And you got to watch that. Because you'll be high-minded in your own ways. And then when you get into a bad situation, you're praying and saying, God, I did all of that for you. It was not for Jesus. Sometimes we do things for us. Well, God, you say you won't put no more on me than I can bear. And the Lord is saying, that's true, because I didn't put any of that on you. I'm trying to help you wait. Pack light. Unload yourself. Don't make any more connections you can't handle. Are you understanding this? Don't give out what you cannot afford to lose. I don't care if it's time. I don't care if it's money. I don't care if it's energy. Don't give out any more that you can't afford to lose. If it's going to make you angry, if you don't give it, if you don't get it back, don't give it. I said, if it's going to make you angry, if you don't get it back, don't give it. That's why you got to be full of love, just in case you don't get that love back. It'll keep your heart out of bitterness and anger. Did this help you today? Come on, let's stand. Thank you for being patient.